Here again is Dr. Donald Grey Barnhouse with a message entitled, Saved by Grace.
Through the Lord Jesus Christ, we come unto thee, our Father and our God, and in the Holy Spirit. We ask thy blessing upon us in this hour, as the word goes forth, that it may reach the hearts of listeners. Lord, there are so many that need thee, some even that don't know that they need thee. And we ask thee to speak to them as we see the wonderful truth of thy salvation that is ours by grace. Hear us, we pray thee. We ask it in the name and for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Today I'm going to speak to you about salvation by grace. I want to present to you simple texts that teach that salvation is by grace alone. My first text is in Ephesians 2. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And then in Titus 3:5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. And lastly, the verse that I believe is the greatest in the Bible, Romans 4:5, to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted unto him for righteousness. These three great statements, flat categorical statements of the utter nothingness of man's efforts, cause men to cry out, but surely God must take some account of what I do. And the answer comes from the word of God, surely God will not take any account of anything that man does. When I was a small boy brought up in California, we spent our summers in Mount Hermon. We went all the way down to Felton to a little store that was the true country store of early American life. There were no electric scales. Bread was neither sliced nor wrapped. And you didn't buy sugar by weight. You got a dollar's worth of sugar. The grocer took a scoop, put sugar into a bag on one side of the scale, while he placed weights on the other side. And I can remember his picking up the scoop and pouring the sugar into the bag until there came that magic moment when there was just enough and the scales balanced. And he upended his scoop and dropped it back into the sugar barrel. How many were there? A dollar's worth of sugar. Somebody says, well, I think there were 12, because I once read in a book that in early American history that they sold 12 pounds of sugar for a dollar. Someone else says, no, I think there were 13. I visited my aunt who had a grocery store, and I personally weighed out 13. Someone else says, well, my father told me that his father told him that his father told him, and it's a strong family tradition, that there were 12 and a half pounds of sugar for the dollar. Now, you see, one is arguing on the basis of what he's read in a book, another on human experience, and the third on family tradition. But I say, wait a minute, there were 14 pounds in the scales. There were 2 5-pounds, and then there was a 2-pound and 2 1-pound. Now, that made the dollar's worth of sugar. Now, let this illustrate spiritual life. God says he has a scale, and he has revealed in the Bible what he has put on his side of the scales. Men argue and argue about what they should offer to God. But let's look first on God's side of the scale and see what he has put in there, for it's against that we are to be weighed. And God's weight is perfection. God cannot let anybody into heaven without perfection. But somebody says, nobody's perfect. I just abandon all that type of argument because it's too theological for me. I'll just work up as many ounces as I can, and I'll do the best I can, and I'll get to heaven, I hope, I hope, I hope. Well, this is the quickest way not to get to heaven, because God Almighty is not going to take your offering into consideration when he has his own holiness to consider and his own ways of presenting truth. That must not be violated. In the Sermon on the Mount, the Lord Jesus Christ asked, which of you by taking thought can add a cubit to his stature? Now that's 18 inches. Which of you can add 18 inches to your height by trying? And then the Lord thunders out, be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. And thus the Sermon on the Mount becomes the greatest condemnation of mankind that has ever fallen from the lips of God. When a man says, well, my religion is the Sermon on the Mount, he shows himself profoundly ignorant of the nature of that great Sermon on the Mount. He shows himself ignorant of its demands, and above all of the fact that it was not given as a code to live by, but as a sword to pierce his pride, in order that he may stand bankrupt before God. And so the Sermon on the Mount begins, blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the spiritually bankrupt. For that's the true meaning of the expression, the poor in spirit. And the bill which you must face and which you cannot pay is the perfection of God. Now, there are three kinds of people, very bad, and ordinary, and very good. Let's weigh these three in the scales over against God's perfection. First, we remember that some people say that there's honor among thieves. Well, let's put that thief's honor in the scale. Well, we find that it weighs 2 ounces against God's 16-ounce perfection. So we take the man of this class and all of the people of this class, and we put them over here in a heap and mark over them lost. We'll see that the man can be saved, but before he can be saved, he must be weighed in the balances and found wanting. Next, we take the average man. He's good enough to keep out of jail, bad enough to do anything he wants to do, and smart enough to think he can get away with it. You know, country club morality. We find that this man weighs 8 ounces in the pound, and he says as he looks back at the thief, oh, this is wonderful, marvelous. I'm 4 times as good as this convict you just measured. But I say, wait a minute. You're not being weighed against the convict. You're being weighed against what God has put on the scale. And the man is disturbed. He says, oh, don't be theological. You've just admitted that I'm 4 times better than that thief. Yes, but I say, 8 ounces does not balance 16. And you must have the same treatment as the convict who sinned and came short of the glory of God. So we put this 8-ounce man over in the heap with the 2-ounce thief. And he yells because he doesn't like to be considered in that heap. But this is where he must be placed, lost. Though we'll see it's possible for him to be saved. Now, when you've weighed out all the 2-ounce people and all the 8-ounce, there are very few left in the human race. But here's Judge so-and-so. His heart is open for all good causes. But he does not believe in Christ. We put him in the scales. He weighs 12 ounces in the pound. 12 ounces. An honest man, the noblest work of God. But again, the theologian comes along and says, wait a minute. You're not being measured by the 8-ounce man or against the 2-ounce man. You're being weighed by the 16 ounces of God's pound of perfection. You must admit, Judge, that if all of these people are taken to heaven just as they are, it wouldn't be heaven anymore. Something must be changed if men are to be gotten ready for heaven. And the great problem that men must face is, how is that change to take place? A generation ago, a great Scotch preacher, Alexander White, expressed this truth by saying that God's righteousness was that righteousness which his righteousness requires him to require. Well, when we sort that out, it means that God is so holy that he has to demand of us a holiness and a righteousness equal to his own. Because if he demanded anything less, he would be demanding imperfection. And then heaven would be sinful, would be less than perfect. But you say, do you mean that my righteousness is no more good to God than the righteousness of a criminal? And that is exactly what the Bible teaches, beyond any question. There is only one kind of righteousness that God will accept, and that is divine righteousness, perfect righteousness. Now there are many different kinds of righteousness which seem good, and they may be good for earth, but not for heaven. This can be illustrated by an incident which occurred to a friend of mine who does not see too well. He was coming from Columbia University, and in order to go downtown on the subway, he found it necessary to get some change to go through the turnstile. The man at the change booth gave him the necessary coins, and at the touch of my friend's fingers, one coin seemed not quite right. He exclaimed to the man at the change booth that he did not believe he had a dime in his hand. The man brusquely brushed him on his way, informing my friend that he knew what he had given him. Well, my friend went to the turnstile, put the coin into the slot, and immediately the mechanism became jammed, much to the disgust of the change booth man. Quite angry by this time, he came out of his booth, went to the turnstile, opened the box, and discovered that an American mechanism that was geared for American coins refused to accept the foreign coin which he had given the man who could not see very well. Evidently, the foreign coin looked like an American one to the man in the change booth, but the mechanism rejected it because it was not an American coin. Our own righteousness may seem all right to us, but God demands perfect righteousness, and our righteousness must be in the true coin of heaven, for the only thing that God will accept for entrance into heaven is his own righteousness, which he provides for us as a gift in Jesus Christ. Let's go back to the Sermon on the Mount for a moment. The Lord Jesus Christ came into this world and began to live his life here as he described it himself. He lived among the good people and among the bad people, but he chose to live mostly with the bad people, which infuriated the good people. The bad people knew they were bad, and the other, better bad people thought that they were good and did not like the fact that Jesus refused them. So Jesus went among those, as we have measured them, 2 ounce, 8 ounce, and 12 ounce people. He went among the 2 ounce people and preached to them and said concerning the Pharisees, "Except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of heaven." This infuriated the good people, for what the Lord Jesus Christ was saying, you have to be better than the best of humanity if you're going to get into heaven. This is why it's so terrible for any man to think that he can get to heaven by the Sermon on the Mount. It is the Sermon on the Mount that condemns him most definitely. It is in the Epistle to James that we have the standard for the righteousness that God demands when he says, "Whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all." Now it was into this world of the lost that Jesus came. He preached and he found his friends down among the outcasts. He was put to death by the good people. Why did the upper class people, the moral, ethical leaders, put him to death? The reason they put him to death was because he taught that character can take a man to hell, but not to heaven, and that we must be born again. Christ taught that salvation was by the free grace of God, totally apart from anything that is in man. And by that teaching, he signed his death warrant. God does not love us because of anything that is in us. He said, "I condemn sin, and I condemn it in all men. But I give life in Christ, and I will give it to anyone who comes and accepts life through him." Yes, we are to be weighed in the scales of God, and God alone can give us that which will make the scales balance in our favor. We stand there where the Lord Jesus stood in the Sermon on the Mount, and we say, "Oh God, I accept the fact that I'm over here in the heap of lost men. I'm not going to argue as to whether I have 8 ounces or 9 or 10 or 12 or even 12 and a half better than anything that the world has ever produced yet. I'm just going to admit the fact that I'm there in the heap." And God will give you eternal life if you will just do these two things. First of all, stop arguing as to the amount of ounces that you have in the pound. Just admit that you have been weighed against perfection and that you fall short of God's glory, and that therefore you're sinful. Then it is that God says, "I love you. I have put your sin on my Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And now you may receive his righteousness." Paul sets this truth forth when he says, "Now we know that what things soever the law says, it says to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world become guilty before God. And therefore by the deeds of the law shall no flesh be justified in his sight, for by the law is the knowledge of sin." But now the righteousness of God apart from the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. And so, when we receive Jesus Christ, the scales balance. The full weight of Christ's perfection, the righteousness of God, is put to my account in the bookkeeping transaction in heaven. And all my sins are put under the blood of Jesus Christ. This is salvation. And thus we can sing that great hymn, My Sin. Oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to his cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Now the second thing you must do is to recognize the truth of those lines in the great hymn, Rock of Ages. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. There's the clue. God will never put Christ into your hands till you empty them. He says, drop what you have, and I will give you Christ. A few years ago, I visited Macassar in the Celebes. When I came off the ship, a little Malay boy met me, carrying in his hand a bamboo cage in which were tiny monkeys about 6 inches high, perfect little specimens and very cute. The boy trailed me, saying, buy a monkey, mister, $1. Buy a monkey, mister. I looked at the monkey, and then I went along while the boy brought his price down. Buy a monkey, mister, 75 cents. Buy a monkey, mister. I went on over to the automobile of the missionary who had come to meet me, and as we were stowing my luggage away, the little fellow followed me and said, buy a monkey, mister, 50 cents. The missionary explained to the boy that we couldn't take the monkey. I gave him a tip. He went away happy. My friend said, you know, the story of how those monkeys are caught is a most interesting one. There is a type of gourd that grows long like a string bean, and then when it has reached its full length, begins to swell. When the gourd is in the string bean stage, a boy ties a cord, a string, around a half of it, so that naturally that half doesn't grow, while the other half does swell, and thus a bottle is formed with a narrow neck. Then the boy cuts off the gourd, and makes a perfect bottle out of it, puts in a couple of hands full of rice, and ties the gourd to a tree. The little monkey smells the rice, puts his little paw in to grab it, but as soon as his paw is filled with rice, he can't pull it out anymore. Now, if he would just have sense enough to drop the rice, he could get away. But his paw is a cork in reverse, and his every instinct tells him to hold on to that food. So there he is, a prisoner of his own greed. Then the boy comes and finds the monkey in the trap. Although the monkey chatters, pulls, and tugs, he will not drop the rice in order that he might be free. The boy slips a bamboo cage around him, then breaks the gourd. The monkey eats the rice and is sold down the river. And that's a picture of many people today, of you perhaps, people who have their hands full of sin, full of themselves. God says, I will give you salvation, I will take you into my heaven, if you'll just admit that you have your paw full of something, and if you'll just drop it. Admit that you are less than perfect. Admit that you're the sinner that God says you are. Open your hand and drop that which you are clutching. God says, do this, or I cannot give you my righteousness in Jesus Christ. Oh, if you will but empty your hands of your own self-righteousness, empty your hands of faith in your church membership or faith in your baptism, drop everything and come in absolute emptiness as a spiritual bankrupt, God will give you Christ. God is satisfied with Christ's righteousness, and he will enable you to balance his demands perfectly in his scale. All of this may be summed up in Toplady's great hymn, Not the labors of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know, could my tears forever flow, all for sin could not atone, thou must save and thou alone. Nothing in my hand I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked, come to thee for dress. helpless, look to thee for grace. Foul, I to the fountain fly. Wash me, Savior, or I die. And our God and Father, we pray thee that thou shalt cause us to see ourselves as thou dost see us, guilty, vile, and helpless we, and then cause us to see Jesus as thou dost see him. Spotless Lamb of God was he. Full atonement, can it be? Hallelujah, what a Savior. Speak to each heart this day, we ask, in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.